Hi, I'm Sukanya Venkatraghavan, and you have to subscribe to the Books on Toast YouTube channel or I will turn you into a toad.
And I'll probably send Earth and Evolution to your house, and believe me, that's not pretty. So subscribe.
Hello and welcome to another very magical episode of the podcast. I'm Sharon.
I'm Anuya.
So this is a very special podcast in which we are doing a nod to female representation in fantasy. So characters, authors, stories, plots, blah, blah, blah. Joining us today is...
Sukanya Venkatraghavan.
Sejal Mehta.
Sejal and Sukanya, before we begin, why don't you guys introduce yourselves to our audience who probably doesn't know who you are.
That's probably. Right. So I'm Sukanya Venkatraghavan. I wrote a book called Dark Things, which came out about 4 years ago, I think.
Which we've discussed in our Monsters episode.
Yeah, you did that. This is true. And this book is a result of me trying to write my second book, which, as you can see, does not exist yet. So instead, I brought out an anthology, which has 13 writers other than... I have a story in it too, and I edited it, and it's called Magical Women. And it's going to be out end April. And yeah, that's who I am.
Sejal.
So I'm a wildlife writer and editor, and I also write fiction and children's books. And of course, I've got one story in Sukanya's anthology.
It's really magical. In fact, Trisha Das, whose story is in this book, told us that she was contributing to this anthology. Yeah. And we were like, what? Why don't we know about this already? Like, it just sounds like the coolest thing that's going to be out there very soon. And it is really, really fun to read. So thank you for writing this. And thank you for editing this. Because it's really a gift to readers.
India really needed something like this.
Yes. Thank you for saying that.
And there is a lot of fantasy, I believe, that's being written. But people don't know about it. Yeah. And they're not consuming it. Yeah. And we are all busy reading international stuff.
Yes. Trust me, there's so much fantasy, which is probably still very mythology oriented.
Yes.
But it's happening. Like, if you go to Amazon and you probably search for my book, and then they'll say books similar to this, you will find at least 5 new books that seem to be in from the fantasy, mytho, history genre. And you're like, who are the people, right? Like, why don't we know more about this? And why do we still keep saying fantasy is this new genre? Like, because it's still a baby. Like, we have to look after it. We must let it grow. Like, it's stupid because it's so many books are coming out. I guess, like, awareness is less, though.
Awareness is less, yeah. In fact, what I liked is that I went through the list of authors and it doesn't have the usual suspects.
Correct.
That makes me happy because it's like there is so much more out there just waiting for us to discover it. And there are all these writers that we don't really know about. So, good job. Looking around you, Sukanya.
So most of the authors, out of the 14, I think at least 6 or 7 are fantasy authors. Or mythology, mytohistory, fantasy authors. Mm-hmm. Which may come as a surprise to a lot of people. Because they're like, really? There are so many fantasy writers in India. But Sujatha SV, Trisha Das' last book was kind of like... Krishna, Udayasankar, I've written fantasy... Shweta, Taneja.
Come on, guys.
I mean, Kiran, Manral's written horror.
Yeah.
Correct. So, I mean, come on. Like, it exists. It's not, you know, it's not so rare.
I think that what you've done in, when you said looking around you, I think that has really helped also. Because everybody writes in a genre. Mm. And even if you're not writing fantasy, which I don't usually write about, but it really helped to draw experiences from what I already do. Mm-hmm. I mean, even conservation and wildlife is filled, like, with, you know, help from folklore. For example, like sacred groves. I mean, what are sacred groves really? They protect them because they say that there is a deity that they worship, and they say, you know, this if you hurt this grove, then, you know, it's going to bring bad luck to our forests. Mm-hmm. And that's actually what they told everybody, and that's how sacred groves and the whole idea of imagination and fantasy and a deity, you know, came about. So there's so much around us already that you can draw from all of those experiences.
Okay.
And that's why I guess the book...
Even kind of creatures. We
yes,
have all these...
Absolutely.
So you keep saying, oh, you know, unicorns are in fashion now or in trend. At one point, everyone was bringing out a mermaid book abroad.
Correct.
But we have these creatures
now, too.
I'm just saying unicorns now. You've got a unicorn keychain. Like, everyone's doing unicorns now.
Correct.
Core of this conversation where why aren't our creatures as cool as mermaids and unicorns? Like, we've had them forever.
Correct.
they were our first, like when we were kids, that's what we read about first, whether it was Rakshasas or Nagakanyas. Nagins have okay. Correct. You know, they have sort of infiltrated
and
pop culture.
And they're really, really Indian.
Yes. And, you know, I feel like part of this is also to say, look, we have cool creatures and
as
beings
well.
Too.
Yes.
And you don't always have to look to the West to... I'm not saying don't look there. They have a great wealth of amazing books and stories.
Hmm. Okay.
But I think it's time to also embrace what we have. And the only way to do that is to give people that content.
Mm.
Is to give them and to give it to them in a package that they are like, oh, this is actually cool. This is actually entertaining, you know, and I want to know more about this.
And something that you can relate to also.
Something that you can relate to. So
yeah.
I think that was also part of wanting to do something like this, because I was like, we have so many magical beings.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And we don't really know about them. And kids today don't know that this is our own culture and folklore.
Absolutely.
Wealth is astounding, and kids are still on Peppa Pig, and which is fine.
Which is okay.
But they should
yeah.
also know this.
Correct.
And I
correct.
Think that is part of doing this.
A huge part of to take that, you know, that we have magical beings here as well. A huge part of Fisher folklore is also about the ocean and whales.
Mm.
I mean, we don't even think about whales as in that sense as magical beings. But when they come across a whale, there are certain fishers who actually carry, like they'll break a coconut and stuff because they think that she's the protective
like
entity,
deity.
Yes,
okay.
of the oceans. And imagine stories about those things, which we don't have access to. She's absolutely right. We are looking to the West, but we have so many magical creatures right here.
Mm-hmm. I'm somebody who hasn't read much, to be honest. And I've always had issues with finding access, especially in the Indian lexicon. And we've all grown up reading like Panchtantra and folk tales and Amar Chitrakatha and Jataka tales and all of this. And it seems like it's so fertile with all this, you know, potential, but one doesn't know how to find it. So why don't you guys tell me one by one, what is the first sort of compelling work of fantasy you read that had women at the forefront?
So I grew up reading Amar Chitrakatha largely, and there was also this, I grew up in Kerala, guys, so there was this
Yakshi.
Malayalam Yakshis. So Yakshis was my school, the nanny at school used to say, don't go near that frangipani tree, there's a Yakshi on it. And that's how I'm upset. So I had to go near the tree, of course. There was no Yakshi on it, or at least she didn't present herself to me. But Kerala is so full of this folklore of Yakshis and other, you know, Brahma Rakshas is another folklore creature.
What
yeah.
is that?
Brahma Rakshas is, I think, if I, please correct me guys later when you see this, I think it's a priest or some kind of a person who offers prayers. If he's been murdered in a very bloody fashion, then he comes Ooh. Back and he's just like floating around looking really sad. And
like
they're not
from the
they're not
yeah.
violent or anything.
Nearly
just,
headless Nick.
Yeah, something like that. But they'll float past your window and you'll get a little scared, but they're not going to like really hurt you. Yakshis will hurt you.
Okay.
Yeah,
which
Yakshi,
is what I like. And there's a reason behind, I mean, again, there's so much of our own societal baggage behind why you would create a creature like Yakshi in stories.
Right.
Mm.
You know, someone who's had a bloody history with men where she's been treated badly, and then
patriarchy.
Of course she comes back to patriarchy, and then she comes back to take
revenge.
Yes. So I grew up, and then there was this Malayalam comic, just like we had Tinkle in Hindi, I mean English, called Balarama.
Okay.
And then I would straight go to the last story because it had a creature called Mayavi, who had he looked like Chucky with horns and could fly. Okay, but he had like a more angelic face. And Mayavi was actually a good devil, like he was supposed to be a devil sort of creature. But he was a good devil, and he would keep saving people from situations. And there was this old crone called Darkini, and I literally named the crone in Dark Things Darkini because I was obsessed
yeah.
with that.
Yes.
And there was another old man who was Darkini's accomplice. And so
okay.
that was my first entry into,
okay.
Fantasy in Indian folklore.
Hmm.
Not just mythology, but creatures that have been created by a writer saying, I'm going to give you a mythical creature and they're going to do fun things.
Mm.
I don't specifically remember female. I think it was mostly a whole gamut of Amar Chitrakatha stories where women were doing awesome things and, you know, creating magic and stuff like that. But if I remember, we will come back to it.
Okay, cool. Sejal?
I actually found fantasy fiction very late in life. I think apart from the Amar Chitrakathas that I read as a child, and you know, like she said, there's no specific character that I remember from then. But I think my foray into fantasy fiction was unfortunately or fortunately with Potter books. I mean, it really made me look at fantasy fiction, imagination. And actually, it reminded me of the time I used to read Enid Blyton books as a child. When you know, the faraway tree, and yes, there's so much imagination in those books that it gives you wings to fly in your, you know, in your own stories. Mm. But that, I think it got cemented much later with the Potter books and, of course, you know, Hermione, who's probably, and Suko herself has said this, that, you know, the most really strong feminist character that we've read in a really long time. Mm-hmm. Because, and I think that was my, like I said, cementing of reading fantasy fiction. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, Game of Thrones. So I'm actually extremely popular culture in that sense. Mm-hmm. From childhood, Amachata Katha and Blyton, straight to Potter and then, and you know, yeah. So this is sort of a re-entry even in terms of writing. Okay. For me, this is Magical Women has sort of been a, you know, pathway back to that. Okay. So that's been great.
Cool.
I think also fairy tales for me.
Yeah, I was going to say.
I think that, yes, I read Red Riding Hood. I'm obsessed with
Absolutely.
Snow White.
Absolutely. Oh,
and I was obsessed with the Evil Queen.
Correct.
And I think these were my first. I realized that women could be
powerful
too. And I liked that.
Yeah.
Because
otherwise,
you know, at least in our mythology, oftentimes women are very one-dimensionally portrayed.
Very simpering as
either
well,
you know, she's got to follow her husband into the forest or something similar stuff.
Yeah.
So I remember
oh no, he's gone and made some vow again.
jungle, next 20 years.
It's a go now.
I remember being obsessed with Surpanakha from a very young age.
Oh,
I didn't question
That's
what happened to her.
At all.
No, I didn't question what happened to her. I must tell you that. I grew up in a joint family in Kerala where, you know, every day my grandfather read the Bhagavad Gita and that sort of thing. So nobody really, I listened to the story and I felt really bad for it, but I didn't question it till I was older.
Mm.
And that's when I'm like, what's happening to these women
Correct.
In our mythology?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I guess the reason I write fantasy fiction the way I do or I curate books like this is because I want to retell their stories or reclaim their narratives in a sense.
For me also it was fairy tales. That was my earliest introduction to fantasy. And you know, you used to get those tiny ladybird classics.
Ladybird
Yes, of course.
Individual fairy tales in them.
Yeah.
And they introduced me to some really like different ones from our there was that The Little Match Girl, which was a very sad story. There was the one about the tinderbox.
The tin soldier.
Yeah, there were like a fair amount of these, and a lot of them had really strange. There was the one that became eventually Frozen, which was about the Ice Queen. Where she was a much worse character than is portrayed in the movie, of course.
Yes.
The woman
queen.
Who could control the Snow Queen.
The Snow
Queen. Yeah. So, and those stories introduced me to magic, but in that magic can be destructive and very melancholy and sad in that space. And I'm like, this is very strange stuff to give children to read.
Yeah.
But okay, it prepares me for the world.
Yeah.
But Little
suffer.
Mermaid, which was originally a really scary story, like a really tragic story where she has to, they give her a knife to, the prince marries another girl. And they give the mermaid a knife to kill him, but she decides not to, and then becomes Dew.
Yes.
It's a really shitty bargain.
And these other Dew children take her and fly off into the sky.
Yeah.
It's actually one of
Terrible.
The saddest stories.
Yeah,
it is.
Really heartbreaking.
Yeah. So all these Grimm's and Hans Christian Andersen tales in their original form is what I used to read a lot of. And then I also went the Potter way, but Hermione, of course, but I think the first heroine who really stood out to me was Katniss Everdeen.
Mm, correct.
And again, this was much later in life. But Katniss was the one who, she was badass, right? She put herself out there. Again, unwilling, but...
Exactly, she's reluctant. Katniss did not want to be in that situation.
But she made the most of it. And I kind of like that. I mean, it sort of had that real life ring to it, where you know, life throws you...
Life
gives you lemon.
Yeah, which actually brings me to the point that I like that over years, YA or fantasy protagonists are mostly female.
Yeah, now it's just like everywhere you look, there are female fantasy protagonists.
So when you ask that question, I had to think. I'm glad that children today
will have role models
as they grow up. They won't even have to think twice before answering this question because they already have Katniss Everdeen and they have Hermione Granger and
Correct.
They have
Dude, all these
also,
new...
Elsa and the...
Yeah, younger adult novels are all... And they are like 10 books which have all sold like a million copies. I recently started reading Sarah J. Maas and the first one is called Throne of Glass.
Yes, I've read that one. It's quite lovely. It's actually a take on Cinderella.
Yeah? I didn't know
Throne
that.
Throne of Glass is actually a take on Cinderella, which is why her name is also very similar. It's Selena.
Selena Kardashian.
Yes. No, something. I cannot pronounce it.
Serdatian.
It's Kardashian.
Kardashian.
That's lovely.
I knew you were
going to
say that.
I especially love the bit when Khloe Kardashian comes in and says
Yeah.
Fantasy fiction.
Teachers are
going to
say, okay.
Well, it is.
Okur.
Oh my God, this is like haunting me for 3 days now. Okur. Okay.
I'm a serious author, guys. Take this
seriously. Yeah, but this Sarah J. Maas is very, I mean, it's good fun, but it's very trashy, let's face it. Like, it's...
But she also knows what she's doing.
Great character.
It's not that character. She just fell into the trash. But she knows what she's writing
it's
about.
It's like she's an assassin, but she behaves like a 18-year-old.
Do you see why that would appeal to an 18-year-old?
Yeah, I do see it. As a 32-year-old, I'm like...
You want to be in a gown, but you also want to be badass. And I don't see anything wrong with that.
I love it. It's just not...
I'm too old.
It's great fun. It's like you don't question anything that's happening and then you'll enjoy it. But it's great fun, and I have a feeling I'll finish this.
So I've been reading An Ember in the Ashes by Sabaa Tahir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. I love the...
What is the book about?
It's kind of... The world building is kind of inspired by ancient Rome.
Okay.
And it's sort of a Middle Eastern story about how, you know, these people have just taken over this entire country and they've just stripped it off culture and... music and art, and it's all about just fighting and soldiers and breeding soldiers and how there's a revolution.
Sparta.
It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. It's quite more, I think, currently maybe ISIS or Taliban or like maybe going into that direction a little more. Mm-hmm. And I think it's so relevant to our times today in some sense. And both the main the girl and the boy, I mean, they're very they really speak to you. So I think that's
but I also have to say that
I think she's
Yeah,
I also wanted to say that, I mean, we were talking about the protagonists and, you know, powerful female characters. But I'm also very fond of the Lunas and the, you know, the Jinnies and the women who actually don't, they're not the chosen ones. They're not the ones who Mrs. Weasley, my goodness.
Yes.
These are not the women leading the war in, I mean, the strictest sense of the word.
But they're the ones supporting.
But, and I think I can relate actually to a lot of them. I don't think I can, I mean, though I love Hermione, I don't think I relate to her as much because I don't have a perfection. I don't have, like, her resourcefulness. Mm. I'm actually, you know, more like Luna maybe.
I'm a Luna.
So,
I'm a Ron. I'm like, this is very boring. I'm leaving.
Yeah.
Arman and...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like, so that's exactly... So I think there's a lot to be said about the women who aren't the chosen ones, but are still so powerful in their own way. And I don't think the protagonist would be anywhere without, their support.
She's my hero. She's one of my favorites. She was in the original Order of the Phoenix.
Yeah.
Yes.
She's... Tuck it through Hogwarts.
Yeah.
She's kind of quietly steering all these children towards...
Correct.
Towards a better...
Like,
And Dumbledore themselves.
is out there doing his cycle Dumbledore things.
When I grow up, I want to be her.
Correct.
Seriously. Yeah. Me also.
I only have the... I have the active witch face is already on. I just need the hat. I'll be done. I'll be fine.
So for me, if you guys could each recommend one book that I must read, which is like right up there when it comes to women and fantasy, what would that be?
Ooh. So I,
oh my goodness.
I usually have you read Dark Things?
You cannot talk about your book.
Well, I have read.
Let anybody
else plug.
Yeah, I'll probably do it.
What is Dark Things about?
Okay, yeah.
You know, at this point, I have read it so many times that I can summarize it chapter for chapter.
Dark Things ki sabse badi.
Why don't you give a summary?
You give summary because you've been
Dark Things is about a Yakshi named Ardra who lives in Atala with Queen Hera. And her job is to seduce men and then take away their secrets and then present them to Queen Hera. And then one day, and after she does that, the men die. And then one day, a man doesn't die. And then everything changes. So in order to read what happens, you have to read
Dark Things.
Thank you, thank you. Listen, I will not expect them to.
I'll tell you the end also if you bribe me.
No, you can't. Okay, I'm going to. I'm actually going to recommend this beautiful book by one of my favorite authors. She's Liney Taylor, and it's the Daughter of Smoke and Bone series. I recommend it to everybody because it has this amazing blue-haired, protagonist in it who meets an angel called Akiva.
Okay.
It's the world building, the romance, their motivations, everything. The first book is just perfect. That's all I can say.
Okay.
And then it will make you read the next two, but the first book you must read.
Okay. Better than Sarah J. Maas?
Yes.
Okay.
Cool. Oh my God, did I say that? Yes.
Yes.
Okay. For me, yes. Personally.
I've seen Liney Taylor everywhere, on every Bookstagrammer, Booktuber.
Daughter of Smoke and Bone is like a, you just have to, someone says, how do I write like romantic fantasy? But also say more things that need are more important than just like two people falling in love. And
correct.
Like doing, you know, bug-eyed things. Hand them like Daughter of Smoke and Bone. That's
bug-eyed
it.
Things is my new favorite phrase. Also phase.
Like this.
Okay, okay. That's a good recommendation, Sejal.
I'd actually...
you have to give me another book.
Magical Thing.
Oh,
magical
no. Women. Magical Thing. She's cheating.
Dark Things and Magical Women made a baby.
There's so
and
much plugging happening. Yeah.
Oh, but it's right here.
It's right here. Actually, I'm really... I'll tell you why.
Okay.
Magical Women. Because I think, like I said, it's not the usual suspects. A, because usual suspects, everybody will know. B, it's about many things. Mm-hmm. Not one character. Like, I actually am a huge fan of short stories. Okay. I love short stories. If I go into a bookstore, it's likely that I will leave with a short story collection.
I love short stories. I love reading short stories.
And I think they're really tough to put together. And I think they're really tough to write as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, apart from the plugging and all of that, I genuinely think that when I've read a couple of stories from the other authors, and, you know, I think they're all really, really fab. So, apart from her recommendation, I'd go for this one.
How well do you think this book represents the women in India? So, the first story itself is LGBT. It's a lesbian.
So this book also, the reason I also say it's by women, it's by writers, is because there are also non-binary writers in the selection. So it's by women and non-binary people. Although it is called Magical Women, but that's because the title is Magical Women. I think, again, when yes, there is a lot of representation, and what I love about the representation is nobody has to fight. It's normal.
Yeah.
It's normal in that world. You're not, oh my God, look, two girls kissed. Or, oh my God, now I must, it's normal even when you see love between two same-sex people. It's just there. And it fits in that world. And if, let's say, a young kid picks it up today, someone who's 15, 16, who's probably struggling with her own or his identity, sexuality, or even if they are not, they will read it and realize, hey, this is normal. This is not something that is to be fought for in that sense. Or it's not planted. It's so organic and seamless. And I think that's, again, I would totally credit my writers for that. Because that's their skill and their craft and also their thinking.
Sharon, I have a book for you.
Yes.
Everybody stopped her and
turned.
I'm all bug-eyed.
I got that one. The Bloody Chamber by Angela Carter.
What it is.
It's fairy tales, but
retold.
Yeah, retold in a very gothic way.
Ooh.
Yeah, I know. Very fucked up. Very lots of sex and violence.
Ooh.
She's a classic fiction writer and fantasy fiction writer, and precedent to all the great fantasy.
Again, one of the early inspirations.
And
writers to just.
Yeah, she was also quite a mess herself, which is where all the great fiction comes from, I've realized. All the good fiction writers are all just like really, really messed up.
Yes.
Yeah. And she died at 51 of lung cancer while she was writing a sequel to Wuthering Heights.
So I recently read this one really cool book, which is by Noor Anayat Khan. It's a version of the Jataka Tales, and it has been republished with illustrations by Kalyani Ganpati. So it's beautiful.
Wow.
And the more, I mean, beyond the tales, everybody has read the tales at some point in life. It's basically like folk tales in the animal kingdom. So human beings are animals, not really, but like the animals that are telling us, giving us these moral lessons and stuff. So what I really like about the book is not just the stories and its interpretation, but just her as a human being, okay? So Noor Inayat Khan was like a World War II spy. And she was on this like intense mission against the Nazis and stuff. And then she was eventually captured and killed in a concentration camp, like shot point blank.
Oh my God.
And she used to write and she used to read a lot of Jataka tales with her father. And that's when she decided to do like an anthology herself. And she used to use that as a way to sort of just deal with all the stuff that she was going through.
Wow.
So like there is this really cool story about a hare that has anxiety and he's driving the jungle mad.
This is lovely.
It is like when you read it now. In today's environment, the fact that there is so much mental anxiety being spoken about also on the internet, the fact that the internet precipitates this is a whole new thing. But the fact that I feel like I'm a hare in a jungle, like going crazy. Like really, like, I mean, just like the depth that she wrote with and keeping in perspective, it's called The Jataka Tales by Noor Inayat Khan.
Lovely.
It just came out with this new contemporary version. I mean, some of these lessons are universal.
So I was, you know how I was talking about owning our culture the elements from it and how you make it, you know, cool and relevant. And I think a writer that I've discovered recently who does that is Nnedi Okorafor. And I loved Who Fears Death. So what she does is she writes African futurism. Hmm. So it's Africa in a futuristic world.
Oh, nice.
And she brings in all the beautiful cultural and, you know, folklore, everything that is relevant in African storytelling and their culture.
Lovely, yeah.
And she puts it into those books.
Okay.
And Binti is set in space. It's a space, it's a futuristic space.
Space
trilogy,
opera.
Space trilogy.
I don't know. I've heard of her because she once argued on Twitter. Talking about the whitewashing of book covers.
Yes.
And it was actually such a genius point where her own book cover was presented with a white white
character.
Girl.
And yeah. She usually has, her stories have women and girls from legit African tribes.
Yeah.
How can you put a white person on the covers?
Yeah.
And their covers are gorgeous because she's very clear about the authenticity that needs to be on those covers. So I think Nnedi is another author that I would highly recommend. Who Fears Death just actually scared the living daylights out of me.
Really?
The way she's... Again, rage.
Rage.
So much rage.
You know, the more you guys are talking about this, I just thought of this author. I didn't realize till now that this is also fantasy. Is Akwaeke Emezi.
I was also thinking about Akwaeke Emezi.
Amazing book. It's a debut book called Fresh Water. And there is a lot of Nigerian etymology in it. So what she does is she owns all the local... So in... Nigerian etymology, the biggest god they worship is like this really giant python, okay? And then and that is the source of all life on earth. Like everything emerges from the python. Everything emerges from the python's mouth. So you eventually, when you die, you go back into its mouth. So essentially, she's
suddenly picturing
this.
I know.
And
just like picturing.
Yeah,
it's like life is a giant game of snake.
Exactly.
There is no winning or losing.
Now I'm seeing it in a whole new light. What the fuck?
I was also watching your mouth open and close. It's python.
Sorry, go on, Charing, go on.
Oh God, a quickie, sorry. So there is, but the thing is, like, she is possessed by gods. Like, she's not a normal human being.
Mm.
And she always feels like she's stuck in this place of a nowhere person because she's also half Nigerian, half Indian. And she's constantly struggled with identity, who was born in Nigeria but grew up in the States. So there is a lot of like shift in just her personality all the time. All the while she knows that she is not who she is. Because there are three gods that live inside her.
Wow. My goodness.
And all of them are like constantly taking over chapters of her life. So when she's a child, she's one god. When she's a teenager, she's another god.
I love this.
And there is a lot of stuff that happens to her in the middle and how she deals with all that rage again. It's just by dissolving her being inside a god again. So every now and then they let her be her. But the moment she's in any sort of danger or anything is triggering one of the gods takes over. I'm like,
it's like a multiple personality.
It's like, what? I read this on New Year's Eve. Like every New Year's Eve, I read one book that is supposed to change my year. So I read this and I'm messed up.
One book, you know, you guys spoke about like books that captured and introduced you to cultures really well.
Yes.
And for me, that was this book called A Firefly in the Dark by this Pakistani author named Shaza Fatima Heather. It's about a 12-year-old girl named Sharmeen and her grandmother's stories that she's grown up listening to about jinns. And then finding out that all of them are in fact true. And so, you know, the whole, there is this entire folk, all the folk myths that she's grown up hearing are all real. Jinns are real. There is a veil that they hide beyond. And I have realized since I read that book, after talking to people, that jinns in North India are still very much an everyday thing.
Yeah.
So there is a...
Hey?
Yeah, so Ferozshah Kotla, the fort, right?
Yeah.
People go there and you will find news stories about this now also. And write letters to jinns that they push in different niches
like
asking for wishes to be fulfilled. So if there's like bad business, they will write a letter and they put it and they photocopy it and put it in different niches because jinns have different departments.
Of course, this is true. Departments of human beings, like the Ministry of Magic, counseling, this room, believe
that this exists and it is so much part of like
the nuts and bolts of
what they grew up with in you know North India and the UP and stuff.
Yeah.
That and this is true for Hindus and Muslims. Of course, it's more true for Muslims because these are the stories they grew up on, whereas we had more the Hindu equivalent.
Correct, right.
And the book completely like introduced me to the jinn in a way that Aladdin never did. Like they were made of smokeless fire and how they were sort of inherited by Islam. They existed before the Quran and then they were incorporated into it and then the stories became part of like the
folklore.
You know the folklore and like the everyday the
so cool.
You know storytelling of for Muslim children and this is what they grew up on. And she's taken that and she's sort of contemporized it and she's made it part of... She's written a pure fantasy. But it is so, like, interesting because I feel like this is a part of the country that I grew up in and yet I was completely...
Yeah, unaware.
Yeah, like, bereft. Like, I didn't know. And the only jinn I knew was what the West gave me.
Exactly.
Which is Aladdin's genie and I Dream of Genie.
Mm.
So, jinn is Robin Williams.
Yeah, I was just saying.
It's not. In fact, American Gods does a better job of...
Oh.
Capturing
the
original, that jinn, then...
I've been looking for a jinn book, thanks, man.
This is a great jinn book, and it'll introduce you to the whole mythology behind
the jinn.
So, and it's a very easy read, and it's really beautifully written, and we've spoken about this in our books that should be made into TV shows, because I feel like it's ripe for the, you know, for the taking, for Indian fantasy.
Also diverse stuff, right? Like, not just everything. Everything is not Hindu mythology.
Yeah,
you know, it's
absolutely.
Indian mythology.
It's Indian
which
mythology.
Is so much more vast than we...
So tell me about your Indian fantasy fiction recommendations. I'm actually going to take Vibhanai.
Superb. What a bridge.
What a bridge.
I will give you one platter.
So
cool.
Unstoppable.
I will give you on one big platter the writers that first exist in my anthology.
Yes.
Because, I only hear, oh my god, Indians, what Indian fantasy fiction? What do we write mythology?
What is
I'm like, what really? Anthology, it's the uncle, auntie, like, and like, what? Why fantasy fiction really exists in India? And I'm like, yes, uncle, it does. But your story, you did not capture it. In Hindu mythology, that is not how Apsaras behave. So,
fabulous.
I'm like, how do Apsaras behave in Hindu mythology? You know, they are dancers, they are pure, but in your book, they were doing things that were not like Apsara. Like, I'm like,
old uncle.
That's
wisdom.
Why it's fantasy. Well, anyway, coming back to my
recommendation.
Super monologue has happened.
Very good. Excellent.
Very
excellent.
Menopausal rage.
Yeah.
Promo.
Wow, so much information this is.
So, for all the uncles who keep saying, what is Indian
uncles.
Fantasy fiction? I'm telling you now.
We will unleash
this. Pay attention. So, Krishna Udayasankar, everybody knows Aryavarta Chronicles. Now, her new book is fantasy. It's called Beast.
It is
It's got a were-lion in it.
Mm.
You got a werewolves. Werewolves hold, like, you know, hold your beer.
So
like
what is a werelion?
It's like a half lion. Human, half
like the mer lion.
Yeah,
but the werewolf.
Basically, you're asking what lion? Or how lion?
How lion?
Don't ask the why lion because that's in the book.
Where lion?
Someday it wear lion. Someday it wear Manish.
Money.
Oh.
fun in this whole
Krishna. God. Your book is amazing.
Yeah, what a plug.
Ignore these people. So Krishna Udayasankar's Beast, and before that she did Immortal.
Immortal,
which takes the mythological character of Ashwathama and puts him in contemporary times.
Mm. Yeah, okay? That was pretty cool.
Then there's Sujatha SV, who, like I said, Kerala's full of folklore.
Yeah.
And it's part of our daily life. So her book is called Demon Hunter of Chotanikara. Chotanikara is an actual place in with a very famous temple in Kerala, very close to my birthplace was Chennai, but anyway, Thrissur. And it's about a demon hunter there who actually rides a tiger. So that's really cool. Okay, Shweta Taneja, who I think has come up many times on your...
Yeah, my god, I discovered her.
So, Anantya Tantrist, who's pretty badass.
She's amazing. Yeah. What a character. Yeah. That Anantya Tantrist
cult
character.
Of,
chaos.
Okay, cult of Chaos.
Superb
series.
It is.
And then there's Tashan Mehta, who wrote Liar's Weave, which is about a boy who realizes that he can change reality if he lies.
Yeah. But only those who believe him believe will be able to see the altered version. It's very complicated.
It's complicated, but it's amazing. So there's Tanan. She's got a lovely story in this as well. Trisha Das, her last book, I think, Kama, which you guys featured again. Time travel and whatnot. And I feel like I'm missing somebody. But Samhita Arni, who's not fantasy exactly, but she writes, I think when she writes, her mytho history has, you know, she retells it in a way that sometimes it could, you know, borderline fantasy. And I am missing somebody. Kiran Manral. Okay. Her last book was, last book was Missing, Presumed Dead, but the one before that was Face at the Window. Again, very adaptable.
This introduces me to other, like, or most fantasy or magical beings that are women are mostly witches. You know, like, why is that?
Chudel.
Kaigo.
Means, I don't understand.
Why are most female creatures... or female magical creatures, witches?
No.
Not really. Not really.
We also have Rakshasis.
Yeah.
We have Apsaras.
Apsaras.
We have Nagins.
Nagins.
We have Yakshis.
Yakshi, which is not a witch.
Yeah, we have goddesses.
We have the earth.
And let me tell, okay, so this is interesting. Trisha Das's story has the triple goddess, Lakshmi, Saraswati, Parvati. So does Krishna's story. And if I blocked out the names and made you read the stories, you would not ever know that they're talking about the same three goddesses.
Wow.
Because that's how they've approached the stories. You know, her story is sort of kind of like Earth's rage, end of the world sort of situation. So as Krishna's, and you cannot, like, they're so different in personalities. And I think as an editor, that was the biggest joy for me to discover how similar tropes, which you say, oh my God, we've done this before. What's so great about the apocalypse?
And then you have
three goddesses, like, amazing. You know, doing their bit. And you're like, yeah, that's how you do the apocalypse. Like,
I mean, I really think that India really needs magical women. I mean, in real life also, and also in the form of this book. Yeah, because... like we discussed, that collective rage has been, you know, just crystallized really beautifully in these pages. And I feel like it says a lot without shouting, you know, without screaming the message from the rooftops. Correct. Everything is subtle and well written and very beautifully put. And I think it'll change a lot of people without trying to change a lot of people.
Yeah. I feel like a lot of kids in small towns would really relate to that, because that is also the background. So
are you planning on translating?
I would love to. Translators, publishers out there, please contact me if you want to translate.
This is the pitch. Yeah.
No, but you know, I like that you guys pointed out rage, but I also want to say there's such moments of beauty, tenderness, there's kindness, there's so much more, there's just... you know, just moments of abject magic in the stories. There's humor.
Yeah, that's funny.
It's funny. Like,
and acknowledgement of other women.
Acknowledgement of other women, sisterhood, everything happens. Yes. So I'm quite proud.
I think men should definitely read this.
I think men need to read this
100% read this.
Yeah, guys, please read it.
Women read it because it'll make you happy, but men read it because you need to.
Men read it because women are magic.
Yeah. Just especially if you think you're woke.
It is only that much...
I want to wrap this session with one final recommendation. And it's a trilogy, so it's like three final recommendations. But
cheater.
Yeah, I feel like, see, that's the thing, right? Like, Angela Carter was someone I discovered recently. And there are women writing a lot of incredible things and winning accolades for them, and nobody gives a shit. So the one science fiction fantasy trilogy has won back-to-back Hugo Awards. Hugo Award is the highest accolade you can give to an SFF book. And that book, I discovered recently was written by a woman because the cover says N.K. Jameson. It doesn't give out her name. Yeah. And she is the first African-American woman to win a Hugo Award and the only author to win for all three books in her trilogy.
Wow.
And the books are, the first book is called The Fifth Season. And the Obelisk Gate and the something smoke.
The Broken Earth Trilogy.
It's the Broken Earth Trilogy.
Okay,
I just want to add to this by saying I think Jameson is a certified goddess. Like, it's just the way she writes. I think she pulls it out of somewhere else. It's not earthly. It's just her magic, her understanding of different kinds of magic and how she uses it in relevant situations is just...
I know. And every morning I wake up to Nick Jonas said, I love you to Priyanka Chopra in a concert. And I'm like, fuck you, tell me important things like these. So... Anyway, this fifth season...
But she's a magical woman.
She is... Jonas or...
that mystery will not be revealed.
Not on this show. Fifth season is about the fifth season, which is like this cataclysmic climate change that occurs.
Amazing. Yes.
On
you would
this,
like it.
Yeah.
I've heard about this book a lot.
On this continent called the Stillness.
Yeah.
And then
stuff
that happens around
it. Do you remember the first chapter? Like that thing that there's an event that happens.
So the whole series is like a climate change sci-fi.
Sort of. It's holding a mirror to like, you know, the darkest places that man can go.
You know what I like about someone like Jameson and so many other writers? They're genre-defying.
Yeah.
You can't pin them down. You can't say they're doing this or they're doing this. They are like, you know what, screw it. They're going to do everything. Yeah. And you will like it. And we really do.
It opens with the boy dying.
Okay.
And the mother's, you know, coming to terms with the dead body. And then all around, there's a lot of other shit happening. You can't even distill the trilogy into like a... This is what it's about. Like, if I had to give you, like, a one-line description, I wouldn't be able to. But it's great. Rick Riordan has done a Goodreads review.
Oh, wow.
And given it a 5-star. Rick Riordan.
She's a certified goddess.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So,
wow, guys. So many great recommendations.
Lots, man. But it's a slow start. So, like, my recommendation to everybody is that give it time. This is worth the time you give it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not, I'll read it like, take your time. Immerse yourself in it.
Any
holidays coming up, please take this book.
Yeah. If you like science fiction, and this. You'll love it.
Well, we have long commutes as well.
I feel like magical women, if you've never read fantasy, is the perfect
starter. It's a starter kit. Yeah, definitely. It's a good starter kit.
Doesn't get better than this.
Good thing. Okay, I think we should wrap up. Thank you so much, ladies, for joining us and talking so vividly about magical women.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
So, thank you, guys. The books is going to... Books is going to be...
Books is going to...
Books.
There are
so many books.
So, the book is going to be out in stores. We will put a link to all the books that we discussed in this episode in the description box below. We'll also put audiobook links and also book links. So, you can read the way you want.
Yeah, and check out all the Indian authors that Sukanya spoke about, please. Yeah. And
because if I hear one more time that, oh my God, there is what is fantasy fiction in India, I will stab you.
Yeah.
Wow. On that note.
Bye.
I won't stab anybody. Sorry.